Well, good morning. We want to welcome everyone to our service here at Higher Plain Baptist Church. Those of you who are watching at home and some who braved it and came today, we're glad to have you with us today. And as we begin our service this morning on Resurrection Sunday, I'm going to ask Mrs. Julie Miller to come and sing for us.
Have you heard the wondrous story of the victory for God? How the Lord of life and glory sin beneath his feet hath trod? Sing it out, oh sing it ever, till the hills take up the strain and the saints beyond the river join to sing. Again, have you heard the wondrous story of a wide and open grave, out of which the Lord of glory hath come forth with power to save? Sing it out, oh sing it ever, till the hills take up the strain and the strain and the saints beyond the river join to sing, Christ lives again.
Good morning. Let's take our hymn books this morning and turn to page 138. As we sing, Christ Arose, page 138. 132, he lives. 132.
I serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer, and just the time I need him. He's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to
are certainly glad to have each of you that are here with us today, those that are here and present in the auditorium, and those that are watching by the live stream. And our members know, but pray for the family of Brother Max Price and also for the family of Brother Troy Freeman. Both of them went home to be with the Lord this week. We're going to miss both of those men. They had an impact on a lot of lives, and what a reunion they must have had up there in heaven after Brother Price got there on Friday afternoon. Pray for Brother Terry Teal. He has been battling the flu and is at home with that. Also for Angeline Boyd, that's Susan Burns' sister. She had a mini stroke about a week ago, has an enlarged heart and high blood pressure. Also for little Sophia Magnarella, she is about 6 weeks old, and the soft spot on her skull they discovered to be fused closed. And so that will prevent the growth of her skull, so they're going to have to do a corrective surgery after they do a CAT scan, and so be praying for her about that. Mrs. Laverne Kaufman had to have an emergency hernia surgery this week, but she's doing well. Pray for her recovery. Also for Ernestina Zuniga, that's missionary Pedro Fernandez's mom. She's recovering from kidney infection and pneumonia. She's 75 and is diabetic. Continue to pray for Bill Holloway and his recovery. Also be praying for all of the doctors and the nurses. We know several of them, Mrs. Julie Wheeler and Brother Chris Barnes, of course, are both members of our church. Also Maranatha Andrews, Beatrice Abraham, Grace Thomas, Jolly Matthew, Bobette Edwards, Amber Finn, Christy Bounds. And if you're watching, if you know anybody that is a doctor or nurse, we can add them to our list to pray for their safety and protection as they continue to treat people. And then those that are members, remember to continue to pray for our unspoken. I'm going to ask Brother Mark Lyles to come up and pray for us to open this the service this morning. Would you come?
Father, thank you we can be in church this morning, Lord, and thank you for the day that we can remember the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, thank you for the sacrifice that he made, and thank you for that we can be saved because of the sacrifice he made. Lord, just pray that you'd bless this service now, bless those that are listening online. Pray that you'd be with everything that's done here, it'd be done to your glory. Thank you for your goodness, in Jesus' name, amen.
We praise the Lord with every breath for victories won this day. His arm has triumphed over death and borne its sting away. The Lord arose o'er all his foes and chased old death away. Lives today.
saints of old. Then we shall gain the heavenly prize and march on streets of gold. The Lord arose for all his foes and chased old death away.
Good morning, everybody. Our missionary minute today is the Williams family. They are missionaries to the United Kingdom over in England, and this is their January-February newsletter. So this is prior to the current events that we're dealing with right now. So there's no mention of their status as of now. So we want to hold them up in prayer. We know that England right now is considered one of those hot spots where it's a little bit worse than other areas. So be sure to hold them up in prayer. They begin their letter by mentioning that in 2020 they had their theme for the new year, which is authentic faith. They've used Hebrews 11 as their text for their program for the new year, and then also they've been focusing on heroes of the faith. So that's something that they said has been a blessing, and it's been taught to help strengthen their faith. Also in January they had a funeral for the mother of one of the faithful men in their church. She was saved. They thank God that she did know Christ, and she went home to be with the Lord at the age of 99. So she lived a very long and full life, and they were thankful for her testimony. Also in January, or in February, I'm sorry, they had a couples retreat which was held in Glasgow, which is roughly about 2.5 hours from where they're located at. And it was several days in length, and they also focused on just biblical marriage, and doing the right thing, supporting one another. He mentioned that there in the UK, it's becoming easier and easier to dissolve a marriage. There's a bill right now in Parliament that's called the No Fault Divorce that they're trying to push through, and it makes it easier for folks to dissolve their marriage. And so that's something that he mentioned, and that he mentioned also that the UK is in great need for prayer regarding this. The one way that we all know that Satan gets to a society is a breakdown of the home, and so that's something that he asked that we be in prayer for the United Kingdom at this time. And then also they've been working to distribute John and Roman, similar to what we're doing here in Oklahoma City. And since January, they've had over 10,000 homes have personally received John and Romans there in Skelmersdale. And over half of the city has already been canvassed. Several have contacted the church through this, and they want to us to continue to pray that souls will be saved concerning that. And then also on a side note, I want to remind everybody who's watching from home, if you haven't done this as of yet, and if you don't do this on a regular basis, also be sure to like and share our live streams. What that allows us to do is that allows us to get the word out to folks who may not know that we have a live stream. Maybe they don't have a home church that they attend, and that will allow us to spread the word that we're up here on 122nd, and possibly bring some more folks to the door once we're able to meet again.
Thank you, Steve. All right, let me ask those that are here in the auditorium, and if you are at home and you want to, be sure to turn your cell phone down or off during the service this morning. We will have our Sunday evening service tonight here in the auditorium at 6. And again, with it being Resurrection Sunday, anybody that wants to come is welcome to come. We're not going to turn anyone away. We'll have our Wednesday evening service at 7:30 as normal. And if you're able to watch, be sure to tune in then. As of right now, there will be no soul winning or on Thursday or Saturday. We will keep you updated on changes due to the regulations and so forth. And I think, just in reading what I'm seeing, I think we're getting close to the end of the tunnel in this. And so we need to be praying now. The final decision will be with our president, and many of the governors will follow suit. I can tell, I watched an interview that Governor Stitt had on Fox News. I think that was yesterday morning. And he did a very good job of communicating why we as a state are not at the same level as New York and California in the restrictions that they have there. And so be praying for our country at this time, and be attentive to those changes as they come. Members, please stay in touch with your team captain and let him know of any needs that come up, or if anything urgent happens, be sure to tell your team captain about that as well during this time. Let's see here. I want to encourage everyone again, be faithful in your giving, your tithes, and your offerings. And we've got folks here today who are from other churches, and I want to encourage you, be faithful to give to your church. They need your tithes during this time, and especially where there is so much financial strain on our country, churches need to be able to keep their doors open. So members, those of you that are watching at home, be faithful in your giving. All right, we're going to take up our offering at this time, so I'm going to ask our men to come, and Brother R.J. Saladin, would you come ahead and come on up to the platform? I'm going to have you pray for our offering.
Go ahead. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for this day, Lord, that we get to celebrate your resurrection, Lord, on this Sunday morning. Lord, we thank you so much, Lord, for you coming to this world, Lord, and dying on the cross, Lord, and shedding your blood, and then rising again, Lord, and claiming the victory over death, hell, and the grave. Lord, we thank you so much for that, Lord, that we can have salvation, Lord, that we can have eternal life and spend eternity with you, Lord, in glory. Lord, we thank you so much for that, Lord, and we thank you that we can come together today or on live stream, Lord, and celebrate that. We pray, God, that you would just bless the service today. We pray that you would be with this offering. Pray help all of us to be faithful stewards, Lord, of the monies that you've given to us. Lord, help us to be faithful to give in our tithes and offerings. We pray, God, that you would just bless our church, Lord. Pray that you would be with Pastor this morning as he preaches to us. Fill him with thy power. Help us all to get something from the message this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
When Christ arose, he turned the tide of human history by dealing out a crushing blow to his archenemy. Before his risen glory, fiendish foes flee in dismay. Forever thrown into a state of helpless disarray, praise the one who lives, praise the one who lives again, praise the one who lives again for seizing victory. When Christ arose, he offered living hope to Adam's race by swallowing the sting of death and standing in
place, refusing to allow his Holy One to see decay. Our God will make his own complete on Resurrection Day. Praise the One who lives. Praise the One who lives again. Praise the One who lives again to cancel our disgrace. When Christ arose, he pried apart the iron grip of sin and gave us strength to walk anew beneath his righteous reign. The silent, empty tomb proclaims these words for all to hear. Your sinful self is crucified by resurrection power. Praise the One who lives. Praise the One who lives again. Praise the One who lives again for breaking every chain. When Christ arose, he earned the right of universal praise. The high acclaim of his great name will ring through endless days. Alone he walked the path of death, alone the Lamb was slain. Together every tongue will sing the honor of his name. Praise the One who lives. Praise the One who lives again. Praise the One who lives again, whose glory owns our gaze. Praise the One who
Amen. Well, thank you, kids, for that song. Open your Bibles to the book of Matthew, chapter 27. Matthew, chapter 27, and we're going to be there and also in chapter 28. I want to encourage those of you who can to come tonight. If you're not able, of course, we're encouraging everybody that's 60 and over and those that have underlying health conditions to stay at home still. But I truly believe we're getting to the end of this and we're going to see our country come out of it for the better. But tonight in our evening service, I'm going to preach on what did Thomas miss that first Sunday night of church. And that'll be our message for tonight. Now, I want to mention again about praying for the family of Brother Max Price and also for the family of Brother Troy Freeman. Those who are visiting with us today, Brother Troy Freeman was a deacon at our church for well over 40 years. I can't remember exactly how long it was because he was actually a deacon. He was the chairman of the deacons when we moved to Oklahoma City in 1977. Him and his wife were the first people that we met from Windsor Hills Baptist Church. And he was a Sunday school teacher. He taught our high school, I think the junior and senior high school boys in our Sunday school department for many years. served in the Navy as a young man. He was an engineer, worked for AT&T for a long time, did all sorts of things. And then after he retired, he came and helped at church. He just volunteered his time and would come up daily and was a blessing to everyone. And then Brother Max Price, he was my older brother John's father-in-law. We got to know him, first of all, when we lived up in Indiana, and his daughter Dawn and my brother John went to high school together, became sweethearts, and ended up getting married. And so Brother Price has been connected to us as a family for a long time. And he coached football up there in Indiana, coached basketball. Then he went out to California and coached out there, and then became a pastor. He pastored a church in Los Angeles in one of the poorer neighborhoods. Then he went to Texas and pastored down in Texas for a while before moving here to Oklahoma after his wife went home to be with the Lord. And so we're going to miss both of those men, and the impact that they had will be felt all the way to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, on this special day, it's a blessing still to be able to celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ from the dead. And for those of us who are saved, this is, as I've said here recently, this is our Super Bowl Sunday. This is the day that is to be celebrated more than any other. Now, we're going to read Matthew chapter 28, verse number 1 through verse number 6. We'll go back into chapter 27 during the message. But to begin this morning, let's read here in Matthew 28, starting in verse number 1. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake. Now that's talking about the Roman guards who had been sent there to watch the tomb to make sure no one would break in and steal the body of Jesus. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, "Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said, come, see the place where the Lord lay." Now I want you to underline that last phrase there in verse number 6. Come, see the place where the Lord lay. And this morning here, out of Matthew chapter 27 and Matthew chapter 28, and then finally over in the Gospel of John, we're going to preach on the subject, see the place where Jesus lay. See the place where Jesus lay. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you for this day that we can set aside to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. All of our hopes, our faith is founded on Jesus raising from the dead. And Lord, even at a time when there is confusion and there is fear and uncertainty in our country and around the world, we know that this is sure. And we rejoice in the fact that God, you gave us the hope of everlasting life through the death of your Son in our place upon the cross and his resurrection from the dead. And so on this day that we have set aside, we pray that you would allow us and help us to do justice to honoring him on this special day. For it's in his name we pray, amen. The life of Jesus is the focal point of time itself. Time actually is dated by his life in history. We use the term B.C., in looking back in time at dates that are far, far back, using that to tell us that whatever happened then happened before Christ. We also use the term AD, Anno Domini, which means in the year of our Lord. And it's interesting that in our Constitution, our nation's Constitution, when they gave the date of our Constitution, they mentioned in it, in the year of our Lord. History is His story. It's the story of the Lord Jesus Christ. And His resurrection from the dead is the greatest single fact in all of human history. There was a preacher by the name of J.J. Ray, W-R-A-Y, who said the fact of Christ's resurrection is at the basis of Christianity. Our whole religion stands upon Jesus Christ coming to life again 3 days after His death. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse number 14, the Bible tells us, "And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain." Many are familiar with the name Josh McDowell. Josh McDowell authored the book Evidence That Demands a Verdict. When he was a lost man, he set out to disprove the Bible, and in studying it in order to disprove it, he came to the realization of his sin and trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. Josh McDowell said, "Few people seem to realize that the resurrection of Jesus is the cornerstone to a worldview that provides the perspective to all of life." Charles Haddon Spurgeon, known as the Prince of Preachers, said, "The doctrine of the resurrection is full of joy to the bereaved. It clothes the grave with flowers and wreaths the tomb with unfading laurel. The sepulcher," he said, "shines with a light brighter than the sun, and death grows fair, as we say, in full assurance of faith. I know that my brother shall rise again. Rent from the ignoble shell," Spurgeon said, "the pearl is gone to deck the crown of the Prince of Peace. Buried beneath the sod, the seed is preparing to bloom in the King's garden." A.W. Tozer, that Christian and Missionary Alliance preacher, said, "We understand and acknowledge that the resurrection has placed a glorious crown upon all of Christ's sufferings. See the place where Jesus lay." This morning, I want to give you 5 evidences of His resurrection from the dead in looking at the place where He lay. See the place where Jesus lay. First of all, see the place where they took His body. See the place where they took His body. Now we're going to go back to Matthew chapter 27, and we're going to read verse number 57 down through verse number 60. And here the Bible gives us a glimpse at the place where they took His body to lay it. Matthew 27, starting in verse 57. "When the even was come, there came a rich man of Arimathea named Joseph, who also himself was Jesus' disciple. He went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be delivered, and when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out in the rock. And he rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulchre and departed." I read a preacher's message on this from a long time ago, and he pointed out the fact that since it was in His new tomb and it was hewn out of the stone, there would have been no way for a secret passageway to be in it in order for Jesus to escape if He was still alive. Have you ever wondered why a man who lived in another place, Arimathea, had a tomb in Jerusalem? Has that thought ever crossed your mind? Look at Luke chapter 23 and verse number 51 with me. The Bible makes it very plain that this Joseph of Arimathea, a wealthy man, we could say even one of the rulers of the Jews, had chosen to have a tomb there in the city of Jerusalem. And the Bible tells us in Luke 23 and verse 51 that he was of the city of Arimathea. The same had not consented to the counsel and deed of them. He was of Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who also himself waited for the kingdom of God. So this man, who became a disciple of Jesus Christ, had a tomb there in Jerusalem, and he went and he pled for the body of Jesus in order to bury it in his tomb. That Joseph had a tomb in Jerusalem, though he himself was not from there, tells us that he was a wealthy man, a fulfillment of a prophecy made by Isaiah about the Lord Jesus Christ in his death, about the Messiah in his death. Turn back to Isaiah chapter 53 and verse number 9. Isaiah chapter 53 gives us the details in prophecy about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. It shows us the sufferings of Christ. And this would be a good time, if you have not already, to read and study that chapter in light of Jesus raising from the dead. But there in Isaiah chapter 53 in verse number 9, among all of the prophecies that are there in that chapter, one of them is that he would be buried with the rich. Look at verse number 9. And he made his grave with the wicked. Now that right there tells us another thing, that his disciples and others should have been more attentive to. The fact that Jesus would have to die, the Messiah would have to die in order to become their Savior. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. To that point, there in New Testament time, Joseph had only been a disciple of Jesus secretly, but now with the crucifixion, he became open and unashamed of his faith in Jesus Christ. You know, this should be a time when Christians become open and unashamed of our faith in Jesus Christ. Turn with me to John chapter 19 and verse number 38. John chapter 19 and verse number 38. John the apostle writes here in his account of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus, telling about Joseph. He says, "And after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, besought Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him leave. He came therefore and took the body of Jesus." In John chapter 12 and verse number 42, the Bible there gives the reason why he was a secret disciple of Jesus to that point. It tells about how they would be cast out or put out of the synagogue for following after Jesus. And so that was why he was a disciple secretly. Jesus had talked about how difficult it would be for someone to enter into the kingdom of God who was rich. I'll never forget being home from Africa one time and being here for a Veterans Sunday when both retired General Heine Adderholt and retired Colonel Tyler Ryberg were here. There were several others who were here as well, and some of us were waiting in a van to go somewhere with General Adderholt. When he was there in the van, he pointed out of the window towards Colonel Ryberg and said about him, "That man would have very easily become a general if he had not lived out his Christian faith so openly." The Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 19, verse number 23 and verse 24, how difficult, how hard it is for someone who is rich to enter into the kingdom of God. Matthew 19 and verse 23, then said Jesus unto his disciples, verily I say unto you that a rich man shall hardly enter into the kingdom of heaven. And again, I say unto you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. So the first thing that we see is the place where they took his body, to the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. We see a second thing as well. See the place where all attention is put upon him. See the place where all attention is put upon him, upon Jesus. Now let's go again to Matthew chapter 27 one more time. See the place where all attention is put upon him. Look at Matthew chapter 27 and verse number 61. Matthew chapter 27 and verse 61. And there was Mary Magdalene and the other Mary sitting over against the sepulcher. Now, the mention of Mary Magdalene and the other Mary would naturally cause someone to ask, how does their mention put all of the attention upon Jesus Christ? It's the mention of the other Mary. Who was this other Mary? She's not, of course, Mary Magdalene, nor is she the mother of the sons of thunder. Matthew chapter 27 and verse 56, a little bit earlier in the chapter, says, among which was Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's children. So this was that Mary that was the mother of James and Joseph, James the Lesser. Who are they? Turn with me to Matthew 13 and verse 55. Matthew chapter 13 and verse 55. This verse shows us that this other Mary was actually Mary, the mother of Jesus. Matthew 13 and verse 55 shows us that she had other children after she had Jesus. Matthew 13 and verse 55. Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary, and his brethren James and Joseph and Simon and Judas? So the Bible tells us here who this other Mary was. This was none other than the Mary who was the mother of Jesus. But already by the time of the evangelist recording this somber event, she is referred to not as the mother of Jesus, but simply as the other Mary, the mother of James and Joseph. What Matthew does here, under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost, is to focus the reader's attention completely upon the Lord Jesus Christ and away from the temptation to glorify or deify Jesus' earthly mother. Please don't miss that. Those that are watching by live stream, don't miss that. Now there would be one more reference to her as the mother of Jesus, but everyone needs to know that emphasis is entirely upon, and attention is directed entirely to, the Lord Jesus Christ. Turn with me to the book of Philippians chapter 2 and verse number 9 through verse number 11. There are those who teach in their doctrine that Mary is elevated to a level of Jesus and the Father. They include her as part of the Godhead. There are those that try to teach people to pray to Mary, that Mary can give them forgiveness of sins, that she can carry their prayers to her son. But mark it down that nowhere in Scripture does Scripture elevate her in any such way. On the contrary, all attention is directed to Jesus Christ. All glory is given to Him. Philippians chapter 2 and verse number 9. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted Him and given Him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. You know, I can imagine today that if it were humanly, physically possible, Mary, that other Mary, the mother of Jesus, would be rolling over in her grave if she knew that there were statues of her that people were praying to. Look at the book of Colossians, chapter 1, and verse number 18. Colossians chapter 1 and verse number 18. And He, that's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things He, the Lord Jesus Christ, might have the preeminence. The Scripture gives all preeminence to the Lord Jesus Christ. See the place where all attention is put upon Him. Number three, see the place where they failed to guard His grave. See the place where they failed to guard His grave. Again in Matthew 27, verse number 62 through 66, see the place where they failed to guard His grave. Matthew chapter 27, verse 62. Now the next day that followed the day of the preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, Sir, we remember that that deceiver said, while he was yet alive, after 3 days I will rise again. Command therefore that the sepulchre be made sure unto the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away, and say unto the people, He is risen from the dead, so the last error shall be worse than the first. Look at verse 65. Pilate said unto them, Ye have a watch, go your way, make it as sure as you can, So they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. Now, while the disciples had failed to catch Jesus' promise to rise from the dead, the rulers of the Jews took it seriously enough to enlist the Roman soldiers' help to keep his grave sealed. Mark chapter 8 and verse 31, and he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. After utterly failing in their duty to keep Christ's tomb sealed shut, these Roman guards showed their corruptness by going to the rulers of the Jews in order to get paid a bribe to keep their mouths shut. Look at Matthew 28, verse number 11 through 15. Matthew 28, verse 11 through 15. Now when they were going, behold, some of the watch came into the city and showed unto the chief priests all the things that were done. And when they were assembled with the elders and had taken counsel, they gave large money unto the soldiers, saying, Say ye, his disciples came by night and stole him away while we slept. And if this come to the governor's ears, we will persuade him and secure you. So they took the money and did as they were taught. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day. Listen to me. Their actions are contrary to those of the Philippian jailer. You remember when Paul and Silas were put in prison because of their preaching there at Philippi. And as they were there, bound in their shackles and singing at night, the earthquake came and shook where they were to the point that the doors of the cells opened up where the prisoners could escape. And when the jailer woke up and saw what had happened, the Bible tells in Acts chapter 16 and verse 27 how he drew his sword to kill himself. That was the thought process of Roman soldiers. That was the duty that Roman soldiers saw that they had, that if they failed in their duty was to take their own life. It's important to remember that the Roman seal had been put upon Christ's tomb as well. This was a very serious thing in the eyes of the Roman government, but they failed in their watch. A man by the name of R.A. Torrey, who authored the book Treasury of Scripture Knowledge and was an evangelist who worked alongside of D.L. Moody, said, "Everything was done which human policy could to prevent the resurrection." But we can say today, it was not enough. See the place where they failed to guard his grave. Number four, see the place where the stone was rolled away. See the place where the stone was rolled away. Now we're going to go back over into chapter 28 of Matthew now. Matthew 28, verse 1 through 5. See the place where the stone was rolled away. Matthew 28, verse 1 through 5. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, "Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified." There in verse number 2, the Bible tells us how that the angel rolled away the stone from the door of the tomb where Jesus had been laid. Have you ever wondered why the angel came and rolled away the stone? We should think about that as we consider the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Our natural inclination would be to think that the stone had to be removed so that Jesus could get out of the tomb. That's what we would be inclined to think if we were to think naturally. After all, that is what always must happen in order for us to exit from any structure. There must be an opening in order to get out. In 2010, down in the country of Chile, near the town of Atacama, there was a mine that collapsed, and there were 33 miners inside that had to be rescued. They had to reopen the mine in order to get the miners out of the mine. That's what happens in the natural course of events. But this was not a natural event. This was the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Since he is the creator of nature, he is not bound as we are by nature's laws. For one thing, Jesus is all powerful. Look at Matthew chapter 28 and verse 18. In that very same chapter, Jesus declared, "All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth." For another, he is the creator of that very stone that had closed the tomb. Look at Ephesians chapter 3 and verse number 9. As we remember the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we must remember that he is not bound by nature as we are. He's the creator of it. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse number 9. "And to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. In the book of Colossians, turn just a little bit farther to Colossians chapter 1 and verse number 16. Colossians 1 and verse 16 tells us, "For by him were all things created, that are in heaven and that are in the earth, and visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him." So that stone that had been rolled up to cover up the entrance of the tomb, it had been created by him. He was its creator. It did not bind him. Thirdly, was his ability to appear in the midst showed the uselessness of that stone. You remember over in the Gospel of John, turn over to John chapter number 20. As the disciples had gathered after the crucifixion of Christ, and they were in the upper room, and they were closed in the upper room because they were afraid of the Jews, and they were afraid that the Jews would be coming next for them. Jesus appeared right in the middle of them. Look at John chapter 20 and verse 19. "Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, Peace be unto you." In verse number 26 of that same chapter, the Bible says there, "And after 8 days again, his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, Peace be unto you." Every single word is in the Word of God there to show us that the Lord Jesus Christ is not like us. We're finite beings. We are His creation. He is the Creator, and so He is not bound by the laws of nature like we are. So this brings us back to that question. Why did the angel come and roll away the stone? What was the reason? It was not so that Jesus could get out of the tomb. We've already established that. It was so that the witnesses to his resurrection could see that his tomb was empty. Notice how the stone was rolled away so that the disciples could look into and go into the tomb and see that it was empty. Our text, Matthew 28, verse 6. The angel says to the women, "He is not here, for he is risen as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay." Mark chapter 16, look at Mark chapter 16, verse 5 and 6 as well. Mark chapter 16 and verse 5 and 6. "And entering into the sepulcher, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. And he saith unto them, Be not affrighted. Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold, behold the place where they laid him." They could see that Jesus was no longer there. Look at Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, verse number 2 through verse number 8. Luke 24, verse 2 through 8. "And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were affrighted and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words. So first, see the place where they took his body. Second, see the place where all attention is put upon him. Third, see the place where they guarded his body and failed to guard it. Fourth, see the place where the stone was rolled away. And then last, see the place where the linen clothes were laid. See the place where the linen clothes were laid. Turn with me, if you would, to the Gospel of John, chapter 19. John, chapter 19. I want to challenge you sometime as a study, now that we have a little extra time, or some people do, staying at home. I want to challenge you sometime to try to study through the events of the crucifixion and the resurrection out of the four Gospels and take all four of them and put them in a timeline of events. We have them in the four Gospels now, but the events are kind of mixed in together among the four Gospels. And it's an interesting study to study out what happens in each order. And this, of course, them seeing the clothes, the linen clothes in which Jesus had been wrapped, came after some of the other things that we've already just looked at. But here in John chapter 19, in verse number 40, the Bible tells us, then took they the body of Jesus and wound it in linen clothes with the spices, as the manner of the Jews is to bury. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new sepulcher, where was never man yet laid. There laid they Jesus, therefore, because of the Jews' preparation day, for the sepulcher was nigh at hand. In chapter 20, it goes on, starting in verse number 1. The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter, and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and saith unto them, they have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him. Peter therefore went forth, and that other disciple, and came to the sepulchre. So they ran both together, and the other disciple did outrun Peter and came first to the sepulchre. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying, yet went he not in. Then cometh Simon Peter following him, and went into the sepulchre, and seeth the linen clothes lie. Verse number 7, and the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. Then went in also that other disciple, which came first to the sepulchre, and he saw and believed. For as yet they knew not the scripture, that he must rise again from the dead. Have you ever noticed how that the garments that Jesus had been wrapped in upon his death were not called grave clothes as those that Lazarus had been wrapped in at the time of his death? We're in the Gospel of John. Hold your place there and turn back to John chapter number 11 and verse number 44. John chapter 11 and verse number 44. When Lazarus died and was buried, Jesus came days later and raised him from the dead. And when he came forth, I remember my dad preaching on this passage time and time again, and how he would point out that Jesus called for Lazarus, because if he had just said, come forth, everyone that was buried in that cemetery would have come forth. But there in verse 44, and he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus saith unto them, loose him and let him go. There's quite a contrast between these two events. Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead when he came forth, the grave clothes that he had been buried in were still on his body. Those that were present when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead were told to remove them from him. But this was not the case with the Lord Jesus Christ. And the clothes that he was buried in were never in Scripture referred to as grave clothes. They were always referred to as linen clothes. So there is a difference here. In John chapter 19, as we read in verse number 40, it says, then took they the body of Jesus and wound it in linen clothes with spices. Notice also the order with which the linen clothes were laying. When we read there in John chapter 20, and verse number 6 and verse number 7, we get the impression that this was a tidy scene. It was not unkept. It was not as we sometimes leave our bed unmade. Look at John 20, verse 6 and 7. Then cometh Simon Peter following him, and went into the sepulchre, and seeth the linen clothes lie, and the napkin that was about his head not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. If I were able, I would like to ask some questions of those rulers of the Jews who were sure that the body of Jesus would be stolen from the tomb by his disciples. First, if Jesus' body was stolen, why were the grave clothes left behind? Have you ever asked that question? Two, if Jesus' body was stolen and the linen clothes in which he had been wrapped were left behind, why were they found so neatly laid in such pristine order? Third, if Jesus' body was stolen by his disciples, why were they so surprised that his body was missing from its tomb? Each account, every part of the resurrection story, every person that witnessed at the tomb or inside the tomb, every one of them were surprised by the news that Jesus' body was no longer in his tomb. Ask anyone whose home has ever been robbed. Thieves and robbers, they do not take time to tidy up before they leave. They leave disorder and disarray. Now this brings us to another question that cannot be answered. If the linen clothes in which he had been wrapped were left behind, what was Jesus wearing when he left the tomb? That question never dawned on me until preparing this message. We know that he had to be wearing something because nothing is recorded stating otherwise. And there was no unfavorable reaction by either the women or his disciples when they all saw him. Since the Bible does not answer that particular question, what was Jesus wearing, it should be understood that we are not to focus then upon the actual clothing that he was wearing. The women had not. Peter did not. John did not. In writing his gospel, John brings our attention right to the purpose of the linen clothes lying in the tomb, though. It was so that he could believe. Look at John chapter 20 and verse number 8 again. John 20 and verse number 8. Those linen clothes were left there by our Savior so that when John entered that tomb and saw them, he would believe. Then went in also that other disciple, which came first to the sepulcher, and he saw and believed. It was so also that we could believe. Look at verse 29. Starting in verse 29, Jesus saith unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. Just a couple of verses later in verse number 31, but these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. There was a man by the name of Albert Bertel Thorwaldsen, who was a Danish sculptor of international renown, who spent most of his life in the country of Italy. He had been born in Copenhagen into a Danish-Icelandic family of humble means in 1770 and was accepted to the Royal Danish Academy of Art when he was 11 years old. He was awarded a stipend to travel to Rome and continue his education there. In Rome, he made a name for himself, maintaining a large workshop and working in the neoclassicist style. His patrons resided all over Europe. When he returned to Denmark in 1838, he was received as a national hero. A museum bearing his name was built to house his works, which he had brought with him. In the Pulpit Treasury Evangelical Monthly, printed in the late 1800s, it told how that when the workers unpacked the crates, they scattered the straw in which the marble works had been packed upon into the ground, not knowing that there were seeds in the straw that worked their way into the ground outside of the museum. We can very easily imagine this happening, these crates coming from Rome, heavy because they're carrying marble statues and sculpture in them, and the workers that are unloading them very carefully so as not to break the marble, taking off the lids and pulling out the straw that was packed around them to protect them as they travel. And as they were able to get the marble statues out and carry them into the museum, the straw was left on the ground, and so it was scattered around. Several months later, flowers began to pop up all over the grounds to the amazement of everyone that came to the museum. They were distinct because they were not from that area. They were not the same kind of flowers that grew in and around Copenhagen. And so in thinking back, they came to the realization that those seeds must have been in the straw. What is the purpose of the story of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead? It's so that we will take it to everyone else so that they can hear. You'll remember there in that same chapter of Matthew 28, at the end of that gospel, the Lord Jesus Christ gives the words in verse 18 through 20. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. What are we to teach them? We're to teach them about the Lord Jesus Christ. We're to teach them about his death in our place upon the cross. We're to teach them about his resurrection from the dead. Teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. That is the message of the empty tomb. When we go and we see the place where Jesus lay, the message is the hope of salvation only through the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me ask you to bow your heads this morning. With heads bowed and with eyes closed, I want to ask the question, not only to those who are here today, but those who may be watching. Do you know for sure, if you were to die today, that heaven will be your home? The only way for anyone to be completely sure of that is through Jesus Christ, through His death, burial, and resurrection from the dead. Jesus paid the ultimate sacrifice for our sins, and His resurrection from the dead gives us the hope of everlasting life. Maybe you're watching today by live stream, and if you are and you're not saved, I want to just lead you in a sinner's prayer, and realizing that the prayer itself does not save. All it is are words that help us to communicate to God. The Lord Jesus Christ did all of the work that was necessary for salvation when He died on the cross. So if you're watching this morning and you want to be saved, all you need to do is trust in Him. You can tell Him this: Jesus, I know that I am a sinner and deserve to go to hell. I know that You died in my place and shed Your blood to cover my sins. Jesus, come into my heart and save my soul right now. I'm trusting in You alone to take me to heaven when I die. Now, if you just prayed that prayer right then, if you meant it with all of your heart, Jesus saved you from your sins. He gave you eternal life. If you did, I want to ask you to reach out to us, give us a call or send us an email, contact us through our website, and let us know about your decision. And I want to encourage everyone that's watching and those that are here on this special day to give the honor that's glory and the give the honor that's due and the glory that's due to the Lord Jesus Christ for His resurrection from the dead. I'm going to ask Brother Van Manen to come and sing us a song as we close.
In the light of Thy love on Calvary shown, how feeble, Lord Jesus, I find my own. A poor guilty sinner, condemned undone, yet redeemed by Calvary love, Calvary love, the love of my Savior from heaven above. Calvary love, Calvary love, I long to be sin and its pride and its shame I see in the light of Calvary love. Savior from heaven above.